Dragons are coming to HBO Max. The new HBO original series House of the Dragon is a prequel set 200 years before the events of Game of Thrones. House of the Dragon tells the story of House Targaryen locked in an epic battle for the Iron Throne and power over the Seven Kingdoms. The epic series promises more drama and betrayal than ever. That's a tall order, but they're gonna do it. Listen to the official Game of Thrones podcast, House of the Dragon, on HBO Max, the iHeartRadio app, or wherever you get your podcasts, hosted by myself and WBEZ's Greta Johnson. And to celebrate, we're back. We've emerged from the Citadel to answer your questions. Producer Chris, bring us the scroll of questions.
All right. Dear Maester, from my understanding, the dragons in the book were much larger than the ones in the HBO Game of Thrones series. I've heard conjecture rounding up the difference to production concerns and the fact that Daenerys's dragons were still juvenile and thus not full grown. Will the dragons in this new series be larger? Sincerely, Jerry.
Jerry, they're going to be larger. Daenerys's dragons, while, you know, pretty huge, they were like, you know, pre-teens, I guess, in dragon lore. Dragons just keep on growing and growing. There are 17 dragons confirmed in the show, and at least one of them, Vhagar, is immensely large and very, very old. Vhagar was formerly the mount of Queen Visenya, who was one of King Aegon the Conqueror's two queens, who were both also his sisters. You know how they roll in a different way, those Targaryens. There's also Caraxes, the mount of Daemon Targaryen, also called the Bloodworm because it's very, very red and lean. This was formerly the dragon of Aemon Targaryen, third son of old King Jaehaerys, who was going to be the heir to the throne, and then various things happened because old King Jaehaerys sadly went like 0-for-13 on children ascending to the Iron Throne. Very tough stuff for him. By the time of the show, Daemon Targaryen, who is the brother of King Viserys, has claimed Caraxes. Meles once belonged to Alyssa Targaryen, one of Jaehaerys's daughters. Meles is currently in the employ of Princess Rhaenys Targaryen, aka the queen who never was. I would assume there are going to be lots. Of course, there are going to be lots more, including some wild dragons who, you know, live along the coastal regions, maybe along Dragonstone. There, there's going to be a lot of dragons. It's going to be fun. Next question.
All right, Maester J, which Valyrian steel swords might be featured on the show? Also, I saw a dagger in the trailer. Are we to believe that is the cat's paw dagger? Thank you from Daniel.
That is the cat's paw dagger. That is the weapon most famously used in the attempt on Bran Stark's life in season one of Game of Thrones. We know that two Valyrian steel swords from House Targaryen's weapon room are in use at this time. Blackfyre, the sword of Targaryen king since the time of Aegon, you can actually see in the trailer, is in the possession of King Viserys. Dark Sister, once the personal weapon of Aegon's sister Visenya, one of the legendary Targaryen troublemaking ladies, is currently in the possession of Daemon Targaryen, again, the brother of King Viserys, who is also himself a troublemaker. Fun facts about those two swords. Blackfyre gave its name to the series of civil wars known as the Blackfyre Rebellion because King Aegon IV, who was the worst of the Targaryen kings, at least the biggest dummy of the Targaryen kings, and certainly a guy who liked to party more than do responsible shit running the realm, he gave the sword to his bastard son Daemon. He also had a lot of bastard kids that he then legitimized, causing this huge, you know, friction within the realm of multiple like groups now vying for power. And because he had given his bastard son the sword of kings, a lot of people were like, oh, I guess that guy should be king. Daemon ended up dying in 196 at the epic battle of Redgrass Field, which basically ended the first Blackfyre Rebellion. His brother, Aegor Bittersteel Rivers, another bastard, took the sword, fled to Essos, and founded the Golden Company, a famed mercenary company, which you will recall from later seasons of Game of Thrones. The sword was last known to be in his possession, so maybe still in Essos somewhere. Dark Sister was last in the possession of Brynden Rivers, another Targaryen bastard, another bastard of Aegon IV, this one who stayed loyal to the crown. Now, Brynden, former hand to the king, took the black and went with our good friend Aemon Targaryen, a.k.a. Maester Aemon, to the wall. And you might know Brynden Rivers better as the Three-Eyed Crow, a.k.a. Blood Raven, a.k.a. the guy that Bran Stark met under the tree and talked to. Question, did Brynden take the sword with him to the wall? We don't know. No one knows where it is, but there's a chance. Other Valyrian steel weapons that maybe we'll see, Lady Forlorn, which was the sword of House Corbray from the Fingers along the coast of the Vale. They call them the Fingers because they're little peninsulas that look like fingers. Fun fact, during the Battle of the Redgrass Field, Gawain Corbray fought a famous duel against Daemon Blackfyre, so it was Valyrian sword against Valyrian sword. House Harlaw of the Iron Islands has Nightfall. I think it's an off chance that we see that one. And then, of course, House Stark has Ice, the great sword of Lord Stark's from time immemorial. And that is a couple of centuries away from being melted down in the events of Game of Thrones.
Next up. Hi, Jason. Very excited to hear you talk about Westeros and maybe get to hear some updates and some hot takes from Hisdar from Marine. My question, do you think at any point we actually get to see Aegon's conquest in a flashback, or do you think they want to do it as its own show or season? Thanks for the great content from Brandon.
Thank you, Brandon. Brandon the Builder. My guess is no. Over the course of the series, does it happen to be at a flashback? Maybe. I guess there's a chance. But to this point in the books, Aegon has been kind of a blank slate. We don't really know what drives him. We know more about the personalities of his sisters, Visenya and Rhaenys, than we do about Aegon the Conqueror. And I think that feels very purposeful. And it feels like that mystery is not going to be revealed until, you know, later things in the books. That's just a guess.
Okay, and next. Seems like just yesterday I was reading Ask the Maester columns every Wednesday after the episode of Game of Thrones. My question, after your tour of Westeros' pod, I started thinking about Essos and other locations around the world. What new or old locations across the narrow sea are you most excited to see in the new show? Thanks from Max.
Across the narrow sea, you know, I think my sense is we're not going to see too much across the narrow sea, but I will tell you what old location I'm excited could be on the table for us in House of the Dragon, and that is the Castle of Storm's End. Folks who listen to Binge Mode will know that I'm a big fan of castles, and I am a big hater of weak castles. I hate a weak castle. There's nothing worse than a fucking weak castle. Castles made of wood, like, why are we doing this in this day and age? Anyway, here's a strong castle, Storm's End. The seat of the House Baratheon, and before them in the pre-conquest years, the Durand and Storm Kings. It's maybe the strongest castle in Westeros. People talk about the Eyrie and the Vale as being impregnable. I'll impregnate the bitch, Bronn famously said. But that's primarily because it's just high, 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 high up in the Mountains of the Moon, and nobody wants to fucking go up there. Plus, the Eyrie is really, really small, and it's only inhabited during the summer because, you know, it's up there in the mountains in the wintertime. It just gets too cold. Storm's End is huge. It's right there in the mix on the continent itself, like on the coast where, you know, Dornish raiders are always coming and other invaders are always coming from the sea. Over the years, lots of folks have made war in the Stormlands, but usually people just avoid laying siege to Storm's End because it is such a major fucking pain in the ass. It's dominated by this huge drum tower that rises from the center of the castle, which it must be extremely striking. We've never seen it in Game of Thrones, and I would love to see that. During Robert's Rebellion, Stannis Baratheon, famed fun guy Stannis Baratheon, held the castle for a year against the power of the Reach and others, with only like a skeleton crew of soldiers and no food. Like, they were eating fucking rats in there until Davos Seaworth smuggled in a bunch of supplies. And shouts to him. Legend says that much like the wall in the north, that the curtain wall of Storm's End was built, woven with spells and stuff that keep it protected. We never got to see it in Game of Thrones. I'm hoping we get to see it here in House of the Dragon. Fun fact, in the books, some news from Storm's End in the books in Dance of the Dragons. Last we heard of Storm's End, a young man from Essos named Aegon Targaryen, who is either an actual Targaryen, right? Or a pretender, faking it, Fagon, as the fans call him, was last known to be moving on Storm's End after taking the castle of Griffin's Roost, also on the Stormlands. So did they take it? Were they successful? Find out when Winds of Winter drops, hopefully soon. Don't miss the new HBO original series, House of the Dragon, premiering this Sunday, August 21st, on HBO Max. Want to ask us questions? Send the questions to askthemaester@gmail.com.